going to give you a whole insight into how we did this and how really this can hopefully apply to all of you, secondary and primary alike. I really want to sort of say how inspiring and empowering it is for young people to have ownership of what they're going to actually study and how it takes them to directions you wouldn't conceive they could ever come to. And the impact, the contributions young people can make. I mean, I was looking around the stalls and all the fair yesterday, and you are all doing amazing stuff. And I think what we are here to offer, and what we're here to offer through the Institute, is just a slightly different twist on that, because it's doing that amazing stuff, and then it's actually enabling young people to contribute right at the frontier of research. And many academics have said, oh no, they can't do that, Becky, you know, stop being so enthusiastic, you know, stop it right now. But they can. And I'm going to tell you how they can. I'm going to tell you how the Institute for Research in Schools can help you do this. And then a little bit about the impact on specific schools, and especially on girls. I mean, I'm really passionate about more girls getting into physics in particular, but science and, you know, having positions in research science. And we, as well as sending one set, we send 2% of all the girls. Now we're a boys' school, which sounds slightly dodgy. So we're a boys' school up to when they're 16, and then the last 2 years we have girls coming in. And because I'm convinced, obviously we've got to do far more systematic evaluation, but I'm convinced the research approach allows girls to actually really feel that they can become scientists. And we have many going on, and you'll see some of them in our slides. So, Matthew said about the Lankton Star Centre. So this is what the students call basically two more physics labs and a bit of a room where we could do some studies and do some research. But it has got some nice conversations on the outside. And that has been the model. I mean, it's always existed, this approach of the Lankton Star Centre, that you get young people be the research scientists and they can contribute and they can do amazing things. And so I'll just tell you that a quick bit of the journey. So you see that it has sort of evolved in scale and in reach, because actually what we've got now with the Institute, a new institute to promote this and get people to take it seriously and get people to enable you as teachers to have time to do this research. What we have with that is some big national projects which you can get involved in straight away, and then you can join up and be part of what we're doing with a whole range of other things. And by definition, what we don't want is do this research. That's not how we operate it. You're particularly interested in, well, one example I'll give you, particularly interested in beetles and iridescence. Right, let's do a research project on that. So, you know, it's really bottom up, what is going to inspire you, what's going to get you geared up to love your teaching more and to let the students flourish more. So, we started, and there's a wonderful person here who I saw yesterday, who I met on my very first FOX training, Rosa from Portugal, if she's here. So, it's a big international effort, the FOX telescope, and I don't know if you know about it, but it's basically a telescope in Hawaii and a telescope in Australia. And you used to be able to get live time, so you'd go on the internet and it said, your session now starts, and you're controlling, and you had little year eights like, this is really good. You see a webcam, you see the thing slew around, you think, come on, it's going to take a picture. You then get into a nebula, and people go, oh, no, surely that's a fake. Surely somebody's put a Hubble picture in there, but it's not. And this is the Whirlpool Galaxy, which we took a picture of. And these lovely students, so this is Lily, who actually went on to do medicine, that was very early days. And this is Tris, who just took hold of this himself, and he said, well, look, we can create a whole group of us looking at different things. What we'll choose is near-Earth objects. He found two brand new near-Earth objects, got them all written up in the Harvard Minor Planet Center. And as a result, and I'm sure this is not just random, loads of the people who do this research in schools go on and carry on research. So Tris did engineering at Bristol University, and then he's doing a PhD on the moon, actually in Oxford. But actually looking at the moon and looking at the reflections and stuff of the moon. So he's finishing off his PhD right now. We then moved on, rather serendipitously, to plasma physics. I think, why did you do that? Well, we happened to be in touch with a fantastic Professor Steve Rose at Imperial. And he said, oh, I could set your students some real problems. And we said, well, let's see how we go with this, shall we? And got them up to a seminar in Imperial. And you can do this with your local university. They're actually, the idea of doing some sustained research, not just doing the one-off talk, something where they keep revisiting. If you find the right academic, this is where we want to help you with the Institute. So we started in, and about a year later, this paper, Pete Hatfield, using the iron intensity ratios, is standard A-level physics thing, not, I think. So quite amazing stuff. That was done by a 17-year-old student who was at the Lambton Star Centre. It's cited often in big scientific conferences, and people say, what is this Lambton Star Centre? What sort of research is it doing? You say it's a school. And they say, but this has been proper, single author paper contributing to scientific research. And this is possible. This is what students can do. Just give them the opportunity. Now, one whole group of projects which we do, which are now becoming national and hopefully international, it would be wonderful if, as a result of this conference, we could somehow get groups of countries to all come together and use technology from CERN. We go to CERN a lot. I take 100 students every year. And one time we went, about 8 years ago actually, we came across a bit of detector technology which we thought could actually be used for something else. And you think, well, this seems a bit bummy, slightly bummy, but bear with me. So this group of six students, six was not a magic number, I just drive a Vauxhall Sephira and I can fit six in my car and traipsing them all around the country. Three girls, three boys, they're all they're all either doing research now, doing PhDs, or in engineering, except for one who went into finance, but five of them carried on in research. And they made a group to turn technology from CERN, and this was them sitting down and saying, we saw this technology at CERN, these little detector chips. Now they're right in the centre of many of the big detectors. So the Atlas detector, the CMS detector, they've got these trigger chips, so silicon pixel detector chips. And basically they pick up, when you smash the photons together, they pick up early signs of having got a Higgs or something like that. And so they saw these chips, and then we were entering for a competition to put a payload in space. And they said, why don't we put those in to measure cosmic radiation? Lots of these small experiments which are supposed to go on the International Space Station, they sort of wither under the cosmic radiation. And they said, be careful about the cosmic radiation if you're sending things in space. So my students said, why don't we use those to measure the cosmic radiation in space really, really accurately? And in my naivety, I said, I'm sure particle physicists talk to astrophysicists. I'll phone up CERN and see if that's been done. Felt sure that it would have been done. But actually, that's also an advantage of young people doing research, because they're not so blinkered. This hadn't been done. I said, you could go in for putting some fuel chips into space. They said, that would be really good. What? NASA has talked about, this thing invented by a school in Kent. So what happened is my students went back to CERN, met this amazing fellow called Larry Kinski, who works on protecting astronauts on the International Space Station, and so monitoring how much radiation they get. And he helped these students develop the Lambton Ultimate Cosmic Ray Intensity. It's always going to have a good acronym, hasn't it, in a good science experiment? And so this is five of these chips arranged around a cube. Now, you look at that and say, what sort of electronics lab have we got at school? No. We sorted this out and did loads of work, and then it was actually developed by satellite engineers and tested in the clean rooms there, because obviously we didn't have that, but we worked so closely with Surrey Satellite Technology Limited, who put loads of small satellites in space. So we think, right, that then got a place to fly on a satellite. The satellite is TechDemoSat 1, and it was the first UK Space Agency technology demonstration satellite. Satellites come in two sizes, double-decker bus sizes, fairly scientific, and washing machine sizes. And this is a standard washing machine size satellite. and we're right underneath here. And it's got a whole load of different payloads from different universities to try and see whether different types of technology can work in spaces. So we're testing them out, because it's so expensive to get stuff in space. So it launched nearly a year ago, just so exciting. I was asked to send a student out to Baikonur in Kazakhstan, and they said, you can only allow one person per payload. And I tried to do some risk assessments. Now, can you imagine trying to send somebody out to a Russian military base to look at a satellite launch? In the end, I bottled it, I'm afraid, and we all watched it in my lab, and whoa, how exciting, amazing. The actual satellite, when it launched, the satellite engineer designed a camera to go on the satellite so it could take a selfie of itself. And it's just beautiful that it comes out of the payload at the rocket and is there taking a selfie with the Earth. So it's about 635 kilometers up. And in order to get some kind of idea of what's happening, my students, in their very technical way, did a beautiful animation of a satellite going around the Earth and picking up cosmic radiation. Oh, there you are. And then that cosmic radiation coming and showering onto Earth. Now, there's our mission control for Lucid. In fact, you're all a huge group of incredibly intelligent people, and you should know, of course, that would not be a school mission control. You're supposed to laugh at this point. That is NASA mission control for the International Space Station. I've got a couple of laptops in my lab. Basically, what we have to do, though, is quite bizarre. I somehow thought that what we would do is we would get all our stuff sorted on the satellite, send it up, and then we'd get loads of data back. But this is a fantastic learning curve for students. We have to send systematic configuration files and payload task requests every week. And doesn't matter whether it's summer holidays, GCSE exams, A-level exams, we have to do that. And then we get about 1,000 response forms saying they've all gone off and it's all gone to the satellite and here's your data. So it's a fantastic experience, and this is all going to be available to you lot. We've had a 1 year phase of testing, and we know where it is, and hopefully, he said if you hadn't fallen asleep at the back, I hope you haven't fallen asleep on them, he was going to click on that and show us where Lucid is right now, up the back. Thank you. Right. So that's where Lucid is live now. It takes about, so over the south, is that over the south pole? Yeah. It will move in a minute, I promise. This is love. Go on, move, please. That's really moving, yeah. I'm sure it will. So that, Lucid takes, on takedown to that, takes about 98 minutes to go around here. It's surprisingly not moving, isn't it? Go, go. Go. That is live tracking, because thank you. Oh, see, it did. Oh, that doesn't look quite as impressive as it did just because when we saw it earlier somewhere around. Brilliant. Okay, I think we'll call that a day. It is going polar orbit right back, so that's moved there, isn't it? Yeah. Fantastic. So, thank you so much. So of course all this data is giving us amazing new insight about the very detailed radiation field in space. And that sort of thing contributes to aurora and safety of asteroids. And, you know, when Hubble telescope goes through the South Atlantic anomaly, a bit in the South Atlantic where the cosmic radiation is really much more intense because of the asymmetry of the magnetic field, they have to turn off the Hubble telescope because otherwise it gets too many particles hitting at the electronics and turning it off. So we can contribute loads to that. And this is Matt, who's a fantastic student who is giving a presentation. And so this whole business about doing research is not just producing the scientific papers, it's presenting your research as a science researcher would do, writing papers, writing posters, communicating with the outside world. We have symposia for our separate areas of research where students all report their research alongside academic scientific conferences. So this was part of the 10th International Position Sensitive Detectors Conference, certainly a Ron Seal name for that one. So that was a conference which had us in it as proper serious researchers. So Matt presented about Lucid and other students from other schools, all involved in our projects, presented as well. So he's then done a conference paper for an international particle physics conference on Lucid. So then, you've got these detectors in space, and you think, how amazing these detectors, which actually, the clever thing about these detectors is, for radiation, what do you normally measure your radiation with? You get a Geiger counter, you go kick, kick, yeah? And you sort of think, oh, well, you know, if I've got some paper in between, say, like, a smoke detector, and something like a radium source, an americium source, and you put your Geiger counter there, you get a much lower count of clicks, yeah? So the thing about these detectors, they can actually, you can show visually radiation. So you can actually tell whether you've got a wiggly line, which is a beta particle because it interacts in the silicon, or a chunky lump, which is an alpha particle, or just a hit on a pixel. And we thought, how cool would that be if every school had one of these detectors? Well, that was a bit too ambitious, actually, because that would cost about £1 million. But it would have been a good idea. But, so we started small. We've now got about 50, and we've got various people who've had detectors in this room. And the whole project's called cern at School. And that was, you know, when we started, I had this bit of technology in my lab. And the kids, what do they say? And so they say, oh, that's cern in your classroom. They said, is that why it doesn't work, miss? Because that was the time when, you know, cern had that bit of a problem with the helium all coming off and the thing exploding and being shut down for a year. So, it wasn't my fault, I promise. So, that cern at School project was to get these detectors into schools and to get students using this state-of-the-art, you know, most of the equipment that many of us have in our labs is very old. Nobody's got a nice bit, well, apart from all the people involved in this, a nice bit of cern technology. So we thought that would be brilliant. And then we thought, why don't we then enable young people to use this technology to do all different things? And cern rather liked the whole idea of this, and they've enabled us to host the cern at School website on the cern site. And there's loads of stuff on that website and all the different schools involved and what they're doing. And what's been brilliant is all the schools have done different stuff. Nobody sort of copied all, you know, we've done some national collaborative projects, but different kids and different teachers have different passions and ideas about how to use this technology. So it's allowed them to explore and do research with state-of-the-art technology. So this is some early work with the chip, and that chip I've had up in the third floor of the Francis Bancroft thing, showing you how it works. In case you're worried, I don't normally sit my kids in front of the Atlas detector in such a cavalier way. We just photoshopped the Atlas detector on the back, I'm afraid. So that's the chip giving you pixel, beautiful visual data, and these are all the schools involved in the project. I want that to go wider, we want that to go across Europe. I mean, cern would be very interested to do a big European push on getting many schools using this. And then, not only what we were saying about yesterday is having teachers all collaborating, but you've got a whole network of young people collaborating as a research collaboration. And one of my big aims is, I think we need to beat things like the Atlas detector and CMS, 2,500 prop. We can get 10,000 school students all collaborating across the UK to start with, and then it would be brilliant to do this across Europe. So other quick things we've done, as a result of working with these chips, we got invited to be a full collaboration member of a new experiment on the Large Hadron Collider. So we're a school collaboration member. I don't think that's happened before. This is this new experiment they call Magnificent Seven, monopoles and exotics detector at the LHC. And we got written up in the CERN bulletin and everything. And basically, we're doing exactly the same making radiation measurements around the collision point of the Large Hadron Collider. And my students went down to sort this all out and were like, you know, there's where the particles collide and here's the student thinking about this. You know, it's amazing. And what's then going to happen, all this data which is being taken as we speak, because obviously the LHC is running now on the higher energy, that's all going to be available for all of you to analyse. So, our leader for this group, Catherine Evans, is really interesting. She has flourished as a physicist, and this research group has now got more women in it than men at my school. And her, just an aside, her mum wrote to me when she went for an interview at Birmingham University and said, she just fitted in. She just went and talked to the academics as though she was one of them. And I said, well, that's because she is, because she's done proper research. She's given research conference papers. She stood up, this was at the 10th International Physician Sensitive Detects Conference. So it's all possible. And what we want to do is make this more than normal. And we realise there's various constraints, and I know you're all busy and everything, but we've got to somehow make it so that your head teachers give you time to do research with your students, to let them just, at any age actually, mostly we think that the moment we're supporting in the sixth form, but to let you let them flourish and really be part of science rather than just, you know, when I did physics at university, I had to wait till the end of my fourth year before I was allowed to do anything I didn't know or nobody knew about. And you had to sort of, you know, that's what you did in physics. You couldn't ever contribute earlier. But these people have got, you know, all your students have got fantastic things to contribute, and we must try and make that flourish. So we've got the same in biosciences as well. And this arose rather sort of a more personal story. I've got a colleague, Dave Coltest, who's wife has multiple sclerosis, and he thought, I would like to be involved in this same approach, and I'd like to see if young students can make a contribution to research in MS. And he went to the Wellcome Trust, and the Wellcome Trust tried it as a pilot. The Wellcome Trust is the largest biomedical research charity in the UK. And funds loads of innovative public engagement. And so what we do for this project, because we have about 100 students involved, they have whole days off, and obviously that's thanks to the, you know, amazing support of your head, and my head allows this to flourish. And that's one of the things we want you to do at the Institute, is to come and talk to your head teacher and your senior management and say, look at the benefits of having this approach. We can help you get all these students inspired and, you know, get more people doing STEM subjects and more people having phenomenal careers in research science from your school. So, this is the myelin-basic protein project, and it's been going for 6 years. They're about, they keep saying this, they're about any second now to publish a paper on their research. So they've been finding some quite innovative things, and they're working with various academics at Kent and at Cambridge, and you know, this is what young people can do. And of course in this case it's not quite the same as my sort of stuff, because they have to have all the big kit and go through the protocols and things, and we've got the human gene, which we have to obviously be careful about. We're not making, you know, anything dodgy in the back corner of the dark room or anything. So we have to go through procedures and ethical procedures, but that's all part of being a scientist. This is what, you know, scientists do, and that's what education is for. And then the Wellcome Trust saw the benefit of rolling this out to four other school-university partnerships, and they're all doing things which really engage with their community. In particular, it's worth saying, Support Great Trust School, which is round here, and supported by Queen Mary, they have looked at diabetes in the community and done amazing research. And a beautiful example to say straight away is the team which did this research. Every single student in the team got their first or second choice university, and they had students go to Oxbridge, which they'd never had before. So in terms of raising aspirations for young people, they can do it. They can see a future for themselves, and they can aspire to more. Then we have other sort of smaller scale projects which are just in our school, which I'd encourage you to think of your own particular passion, how you might start something. This is looking at what's going to happen for global food security, and we need to have different types of wheat which aren't going to fall over in winds and rain. And this was fine mapping the genetic structure of a dwarfing gene for wheat. And that's working with the John Innes Centre. And you think, well, how did you get all this? We can help you do that. That's one of the things I want the Institute to do, is actually make it easier for schools and universities to collaborate on things, and schools and research institutes. This is John Innes Research Centre, for the BBSRC, the Barn, whatever it is, Research Centre, up in East Anglia. And then I did say a quick word about the beetle thing. The beetle thing, sorry, I called it beetle mainly because I just thought it was a nice word, but the beetle thing is, we had a speaker come, and this is how this one arose. You see, it's all serendipitous, really. He came to talk about colour and iridescence and how you could look at beetles and how they would shine differently in different circumstances and everything, and how their light was given off by reflection and the structure rather than the actual pigment. And a group of three girls got up and said, oh, this would be amazing, could we work with you and develop a project? And Keith Cusick from Exeter, being the fantastic chap he is, he said, yes, of course. So all he does is Skype about once a month. We begged and borrowed and stealed some equipment from the University of Kent, and they have set up a whole thing, and what they've done is they've dried out beetles. They are dead, don't worry, no cruelty to beetles is involved. They've dried out beetles and looked at how they are different colours because the structure has shrunk, and so the interference patterns, and it's all beautiful stuff. And there's lots of different things they can do with that. And so, you know, there's no set pattern, it's up to you. You know, you're the brilliant scientist, and you're the one who we want to keep inspired by being right close to your subject. And being, in this case, actually, got really excited. She's actually the most qualified person in the school in terms of having postdocs and everything. And she's got into that, and that's kept her going and inspired, you know, through coursework and stuff. She's still been doing wheat and rain. So, these are the impacts. I must stop for a second. Huge uptake in post-16, maths, science, technology. 65% of our students go on and do STEM subjects, which I think is much higher. I think the normal average is about 17%. So, you know, and that's what many countries need, especially in the UK, crying out for more engineers, more computer scientists, more physicists. Well, this is, I reckon, scaling up with the Institute for Research in Schools, a mechanism for getting more people to love and enjoy science, and hopefully improve entries at university, enhance teachers' expertise. Well, actually, so many physics teachers have said to me, oh, thanks, Beck, because, you know, it's made me love my subject again. I've got back into a bit of physics, which is why I went. And perhaps, hopefully, it's not all the same in European countries, but often in the UK, teachers get a bit bogged down, then gets curriculum changes, assessment, I'm sure you know that, and just to give them something to get their teeth into and love their subject again. And I've had many people who said, oh, if I could do a bit of research alongside my teaching, I might think of teaching. So let's hope it brings more people into the profession. So, thanks to fantastic support, we are now starting up about the last month. We started this Institute for Research in Schools. It's so exciting, and so many exciting things are happening. Like Nature magazine is going to do a short article on us because they think it's a way of encouraging people into science and engineering. And it is, and it can just hopefully gradually transform science education and teachers' experience of science education. So we've got some fantastic people supporting us, and we've got all these amazing people who actually have supported us in many various ways, through grants or just through support. I have found the sort of generosity of the scientific community and people in industry, and it's partly because they say, cool, I would love to do this like this when I was at school. And so, you know, it's been a satellite engineer at Surrey Satellite Technology, David Kitt, who's just spent hours with the students, and you will find this anywhere you go. So it's not that it's not reproducible. It's perfectly reproducible, and we would love to help you. So really, in conclusion, I would say, hopefully, the Institute for Research in Schools will spread this approach, will enable you to love your Science teaching more will allow your students to flourish, and goodness knows what they'll come up with. I'm always saying to them, you know, it may not be the Nobel Prize next week, and hopefully when they're, yeah, we won't say anything about Nobel Prize laureates at this point, sure. So it may not be the Nobel Prize this week, but, you know, they've made serious contributions. The work which one of my students has done on the satellite is meaning that he's the first ever person under the age of 25 to be on the CERN grid for worldwide, you know, the computing grid, the worldwide grid for computing, which is able to analyse all the data from all the different detectors and lots of other projects all over the world. And he's just done something this morning. I got an email at lunchtime saying he's managed to fix a whole system for the whole TechDemosat satellite. So, you know, this is a 16-year-old student, and he's not unique. He's just given the opportunity. So my finish is, please come and see us and get involved, email me. Thanks to the fantastic Queen Mary, I'm now a visiting professor here, which is slightly mad, isn't it? So I'm just a physics teacher, really, but I'm really passionate about getting you all involved and getting you to be part of the Institute of Research and hopefully improving science education in doing so. So thank you.